Good morning, everyone. Again, it's time to turn to our staff observers in England, Germany, and Washington to hear their reports on latest developments here and abroad. On this, the 579th day of the war in Europe. Let's hear first from England. Will you go ahead, London?
This is John McVane in London.
The report this morning that Count Teleki, the Hungarian Prime Minister, has committed suicide and that the Hungarian government has resigned is causing a good deal of speculation in London. No authoritative quarters are yet prepared to offer confirmation or explanation for the Hungarian developments. But observers who know the country well seem to believe that Teleki acted as he did because he could no longer stand the German pressure. One bomber was shot down by fighters into the channel this morning. The Air Ministry says that there has been small-scale air activity over Britain this morning, but no details are yet available. The German raiders didn't come to Britain last night, and it's understood that the RAF stayed at home, too. Yesterday, during daylight, the British carried out attacks on shipping off the Dutch coast and also attacked aerodromes in Holland and France at a cost of 2 planes. It is stated in London this morning that the Italians lost 178 planes in the Middle East during March. 125 of them were shot down by the RAF and colonial pilots, 21 by anti-aircraft guns, and 32 were destroyed on the ground. So far, the protest that Vichy was reported making to Britain hasn't been received in London, and there is some doubt now whether the protest was in fact ever drafted. One theory is that the story of the protest originated with a German radio report that was picked up by Paris and put out with a Vichy dateline. General de Gaulle's statement yesterday in Cairo that there will not be a state of war between France and the British Empire because French national opinion will not permit it is probably the reason that the Vichy leaders haven't taken the Algerian convoy incident farther than they have. General de Gaulle has exceptionally good information that reaches him daily on what is happening inside France and the feeling of the French people. So when he defied the Vichy men to declare war, at the same time forecasting further incidents between the Vichy forces and the British, it's a pretty good bet that he knows what he's talking about. A statement issued by Free French Headquarters says that units of the Foreign Legion, colonial troops of Equatorial Africa and the Cameroons, French Marines, Spahis, and artillery took an important part in the operations which ended in the fall of Cairn. French bombing planes were also active. General de Gaulle spent 2 days with the French troops in the fighting line. Hitler's order to his legation in Belgrade to leave Yugoslavia doesn't come as any great surprise to the British. Dispatches arriving here seem to indicate that Mussolini has failed in his attempt to get Hitler to delay the attack on Yugoslavia because of fear for his troops in Albania. As the British see it, Hitler's attack on Yugoslavia will mean the loss to Mussolini of his entire force in Albania, set at some 300,000 men. The Yugoslavs can sweep down on their flank while the Greeks continue their frontal attack. There can be no Dunkirk escape for the Italians because they haven't the navy to protect what at best would be a lengthy re-embarkation at one of the heavily bombed Albanian ports. It's being stated here today that possible revolt inside Italy itself will make it necessary for the Germans to occupy the entire country. The Evening Standard today says, "It seems certain that the Italian fleet was sent to sea on German orders, possibly in order to cover a fresh dispatch of German troops to Libya. We can imagine what feeling the resulting fiasco must cause in Italian ports. Italian sailors will blame their German masters. German sailors will bewail the fate which condemns them to risk death in Italian ships. The blood brothers will be at each other's throats." British airmen who have to bail out sometimes do so in German parachutes. This was revealed yesterday by a Ministry of Economic Warfare spokesman. He said that using the German parachutes taken from Germans who have jumped over England saves the British about $140 a jump. Experts from the ministry exhibited various articles captured from German airmen and gave their deductions as to the state of Germany's supplies. One exhibit was a German naval medicine kit. Medicines were in 50 neat aluminum tubes. But elaborate as the kit was, it contained no iodine, Vaseline, or disinfectant, in all of which Germany is thought to be short. In the pockets of prisoners captured recently have been a large number of sedative drugs and sleeping tablets, taken by ministry experts as a sign that the Germans are beginning to feel the strain of warfare. The Daily Express today publishes a report that Marshal Badoglio is now a prisoner in the Royal Palace at Rome, under the personal protection of King Victor Emmanuel after three attempts had been made on his life by fascist enemies. This is John McVane in London, returning you to the National Broadcasting Company in New York.
From the Associated Press, Belgrade, Yugoslavia, Germany ordered all of her legation staff save two men home to Berlin today in a flurry of ominous military activity. And diplomatic circles expressed belief that Adolf Hitler had decided that war with Yugoslavia was inevitable. Next, let's hear from the Reich. Incidentally, when our Berlin reporter starts talking, it will be exactly 5 minutes and 45 seconds past 8 o'clock.
Hello, NBC. This is Charles Lanius in Berlin. The story that is causing more interest among Americans here than the Yugoslav crisis and the German attitude to the seizure in America of German and Italian ships is the police roundup of a number of United States citizens last night. As far as I'm able to check this morning, 8 male Americans, including one Negro music student, were taken into custody about 6:30 last night by the Berlin police. And if my information is correct, they're all at liberty today. Several were released late last night after various forms of questioning, and others were held until about 4 o'clock this morning, after spending several hours in the bullpen. One of the men who was released early today is Mr. John Paul Dixon, 34-year-old New Yorker, and Berlin reporter for the Mutual Broadcasting System. Police came to Dixon's downtown office late yesterday evening and took him off to jail. The American Embassy was notified immediately. And when First Secretary Donald Heath inquired at police headquarters for information, he was told that he would have to get in touch with the German Foreign Office. That, of course, was done this morning after Dixon's release. Another American who was hauled in has been a resident of Berlin for more than 30 years. He is Mr. Arthur Dunning, president of the American Commercial Club here. Police came to his house, told him to pack a bag with clothes and toilet articles enough to last him for several days, and took him away. After some routine questioning, Mr. Dunning, who is getting along in years, was allowed to go home about 11 o'clock last night. The Negro, John Wesley Welch, here is a music student, is also at liberty. The Reverend Stuart Herman, the minister at the American church here, was taken to his local precinct police headquarters, but was sent home almost immediately when he showed his papers. A Philadelphia man, Mr. Alexander Thierry, and another American named Smith, about whom I haven't so far been able to get many details, were both picked up and questioned. Two other Americans, whose names aren't available at present, but who are said to be students, had the same experience. Just what is at the bottom of the roundup is still somewhat of a mystery. I was told at the American Embassy this morning that no charges were made against any of the men. Evidently, they were simply taken in and questioned. According to the scanty stories they have to tell today, they were not mistreated in any way. On the Wilhelmstrasse this morning, nothing was said about the affair, but I understand further inquiries into the matter will be made at the Foreign Office. The Yugoslavian crisis is uppermost in the minds of Wilhelmstrasse officials. An authoritative source stressed 3 points this morning. The first was that the present Yugoslavian government is deliberately keeping the population of the country in ignorance of the actual facts. The second in importance in the German viewpoint is the anti-German activities of Yugoslavian diplomats abroad, both overseas and on the continent. This, it was said, is one of the most notable features of the crisis. Thirdly, in regard to the interference of outside powers, who, according to the Germans, have no interest in the region, it would seem here that this is not only supported by the present Yugoslav government, but is actually welcomed. In any case, it was said, such interference from countries which have no business agitating in that part of the world is not in accordance with a 3-power pact. Nothing is known on the Wilhelmstrasse of a known which the Yugoslav government is said to have sent to the German government. But it's understood here that a cabinet meeting is being held in Belgrade, but no decision has been reached. In this connection, it was reiterated today that any decision on the crisis must come from Belgrade. Meanwhile, officials said, Germany is watching developments with great patience and forbearance. Today's Berlin press is filled with atrocity stories describing how the Germans were and still are being mistreated in Yugoslavia. Newspaper description of the rioting, which is said to have started 8 days ago, compares the disorder to that which preceded the Polish campaign. It said that Jews threw money to the mobs and bought alcohol for the Serbs to incite them against the Germans. The seizure of Italian and German ships by the United States came in for some bitter comment on the Wilhelmstrasse today. It was declared that Germany's protest to the United States would be made public soon, but not today. Regarding reports of further confiscations in a number of South American states, it was said officially that Germany would first settle with the United States. What to do about the South American countries involved will be decided later. There are reports that the American authorities had taken over the ship to keep the crews from sabotaging them was described here as perfect nonsense. Any captain, an official asserted, has the right to scuttle his own ship, so long as he did not damage other vessels, especially when he has reason to believe that his boat is likely to fall in the hands of the enemy. This is Charles Lanius in Berlin. I now return you to NBC in New York.
This is NBC in New York, and that's the news on the other side of the Atlantic this morning. We take you now to the nation's capital for Earl Godwin's report from our newsroom in Washington.
Well, as entertaining as Charles Lanius is, the United States will not release those Axis ships, I'll bet. They may take them over and pay for them. That would be requisitioning. And they may not. I know that they spent many a long hour last night at the White House studying this thing. But the beleaguered democracies need ships the worst way. But what I really had to tell you is that the Congress of the United States is about to rare up and do something about strikes and about the costs of defense. Although the House started off its rampage with a 10-day vacation beginning this afternoon, nevertheless, the House leaves behind a double-barreled investigation into the progress of defense, and that means the strikes, too. Rarely has one heard so much criticism, spoken criticism, of the administration coming from both sides of the House as there was yesterday afternoon, all against strikes. The members are hearing from the parents of the boys at home, and there were demands in the House and in the Senate also for action now to get production started. One congressman says that Red Rebellion reigns at the Alice Chalmers strike in Michigan, and another views the Ford strike as a notable victory for Adolf Hitler. Incidentally, we learned today that the Ford labor troubles are dissolving and that there may be a sunrise out there within a day or two. So also the coal strike. Senators Byrd of Virginia, George of Georgia, Overton of Louisiana, and Connally of Texas have come out flat for a federal curb against strikes. But labor, as represented by the CIO unions, does not see it that way at all and refuses, as they say, to be stampeded away from the picket lines and into the plant or factories or mines. John Lewis, mine workers' chief, denounces the mediation board's formula of back to work first and settle the dispute while the men produce. In this way, John Lewis, always a dramatic figure in any crisis, may lead his side into a position where it is Lewis versus Roosevelt, CIO versus the administration. Congress resents it, seems to resent it, and it to be more troubled vocally at least than about the production stoppages than does the administration. Incidentally, however, while John Lewis takes that position, William Green is reported here from Philadelphia as saying this: strikes to right real wrongs are the inalienable right of free workers, but minority strikes as organizational strategy are quite another matter and endanger the freedom we seek to defend. While Congress prepares a deep committee investigation, Representative Engel of Michigan has been making a one-man tour of many training camps and is blasting away every day or two. Today he has prepared his revelations at Camp Meade, Maryland, within a few miles of the Capitol. Graft, waste, inefficiency, and 250% overages in cost are among Engel's charges. He says there has been outrageous waste in federal funds and asks for court-martials for Army officers and criminal prosecutions for civilians. In the helter-skelter of defense production, prices want to go up. Coal prices, jittery over the coal strike, try to lunge forward but are restrained by one man, Leon Henderson, who's the price czar of the Defense Commission, who pegs soft coal at March 28 figures. And Earl Godwin says goodbye. That's all the news from Washington at this time.
Listen to this broadcast each weekday morning at this same time. To be best informed on what's going on throughout the day, we invite you to keep your radio tuned to this station. This is the National Broadcasting Company. Good morning, everyone. Here's the news at home and abroad, brought to you by our staff reporters in London and Berlin and by Earl Godwin in Washington. For our first report, we take you direct to London.
This is John McVane in London. A dispatch from Cairo, reaching London less than an hour ago, states that British troops have occupied Adawa, 100 miles south of Asmara. For the second night in a row, British bombers last night bombed the German-occupied port of Brest. Six of heavy bombs were seen to straddle the two German warships, Scharnhorst and Gneisenau. The ships could be clearly identified in the moonlight, and it is stated that the attack was pressed home with great resolution. Some of the bombing was done from very low level. Several fires started near the vessels and in stores of oil and in warehouses. Attacks were also made on oil stores at Rotterdam and industrial targets in the Ruhr. One British plane is missing. German raiders last night made a west coast town their main target. Two raiders were shot down, one by night fighters. And it's possible that a third raider was also destroyed. Casualties and damage in last night's raids are said to be small. We are allowed to say today that the Café de Paris was the well-known London nightclub that received two direct hits some weeks ago while the dance floor was crowded with merrymakers. Harry McElhone, late of Harry's New York Bar in Paris, known by name to many Americans, was shaken but uninjured by the explosions that killed many of the staff and customers. He and his son helped administer first aid to the wounded. The other day, I saw one of the new improved Spitfires that the British will be using this spring to batter down German bombers and fighters if the Germans start big daylight raids. A test pilot who was flying it had held several air records before the war. He looked like a movie hero with his blonde, curly hair, but when I saw him in the Spitfire, he was flying at 400 miles an hour, 25 feet above the grass. To put the brand new machine through its test flight paces, he was flying the machine on its side, and the low wing tip seemed to be clipping the grass. As he roared past, he turned the plane upside down. A quiver of his finger would have sent the plane hurtling deep into the earth, but he calmly put it back on its side, then right side up again. The Spitfire idled down till we thought it would stall. Then the test pilot touched the throttle, and its pickup reminded you of a jackrabbit that had just had a firecracker set off under its tail. The Spitfire zipped around turns as the test pilot flung it this way or that, until you began to think the pilot could put it through the eye of a needle if he felt like it. That was only one new Spitfire, but a little while before, I had seen many more in all stages of development, from a pile of flat sheets of metal right up to the finished articles, getting their final test flight before the ferry pilots took them off to the Spitfire squadron. It was the first time that press and radio correspondents had been allowed to visit a fighter factory. You heard that the planes were coming out fast, but that was just what officials told you. It was pleasant to see for yourself that they really are being turned out fast. The great factory buildings are nearly a quarter of a mile long and more than 100 yards wide. Night and day, they are lit by a sort of daylight lighting that is clear without any glare. 30 to 40% of the workers at the machines are women, and the percentage is to be raised as soon as more women can be trained. It was strange to see girls in overalls, some in high heels, standing at the machines that were turning out the shining, perfect pieces of metal that make up the Spitfire. I watched one girl operating a machine that cut a piece of metal in six different ways. Her fingers were black with oil, but she was humming to herself as she worked, unconscious of the fact that I was standing behind her. The sound of her humming, the way that she and the rest were working, made you realize again that this is a civilian's war, that the girl at the machine and the young pilot who will someday fling the finished Spitfire against German bombers are doing essentially the same job. The factory is camouflaged. Inside each of the great factory buildings is a line of concrete shelters. And when spotters report bombers overhead, the workers have to move only a few yards to get protection. About 30% of the machines in the entire factory are American. And one long line of them I saw were marked Cincinnati in bold letters. One intricate machine, also American, was a stretching machine. A flat sheet of metal, cut in proper form, is put in place in the machine. The edges of the metal are held, and from underneath, a great block of steel presses against it. While you watch the metal, it is bent into just the right curve to make the upper part of a wing. Brick barriers surrounded the machine to protect it from bomb blast. I asked the works manager how long it took to train the girls, who incidentally work 11 to 12-hour shifts, 6.5 days a week. He said an intelligent woman could learn her job in about 3 weeks. Male foremen set the machine tools in the proper way, and after that, for the women, it's just a matter of being careful. We saw the finished planes being armed. It is no secret, for it has been published in the papers that the new Spitfires carry cannon. and it was easy to imagine what the increased firepower of these new machines would mean. This is John McVane in London, returning you to the National Broadcasting Company in New York.
Next, a report direct from the Reich. Go ahead, Berlin.
Hello, NBC. This is Charles Lanius in Berlin. The reason for the detention of 8 Americans by Berlin police last Wednesday night was made known here today at the American Embassy. The police explanation to embassy officials I learned is that the 8 Americans just happened to be picked up in a general roundup of all foreigners in the capital. This, the officials were told, is in line with the extensive tightening up of police regulations for all foreigners in Germany. The police say that there's no special discrimination against the Americans. They were just brought into headquarters for a routine overhaul of their papers. I was told at the embassy today that all of the Americans taken into custody have been released and are now accounted for. In the meantime, Dick Hotlett, the young American newspaper man arrested here on March 15th, is still in jail awaiting trial on a charge of espionage. I understand the case may come up before a special court in about 10 days' time. Japanese Foreign Minister Matsuoka arrived in Berlin yesterday afternoon from his talks in Rome with Senior Mussolini. Soon after his arrival here, he saw Hitler in the presence of German Foreign Minister von Ribbentrop, and it's believed he'll have further conversations with Der Führer before he finally leaves for home. An official on the Wilhelmstrasse said today that Matsuoka's return visit to Berlin was strictly for business purposes. There's to be no celebrations, he said, only plenty of work. The answer of the United States to the German note of protest on the seizure of German ships in American ports was touched on the Wilhelmstrasse today. It was said that a partial reply had been received and that more detailed answer is expected here soon. There wasn't much new information on the Yugoslavian crisis. It was said that, generally speaking, the situation remained unchanged. When an official was asked if developments were becoming increasingly sharp, he replied that further sharpening is scarcely possible. He added that for all practical purposes, diplomatic relations with Yugoslavia are almost completely broken off, although formally, the Germans still have relations with the Yugoslavian minister who is still in Berlin. In Belgrade, the German legation is said to be surrounded by a heavy armed guard to prevent incidents. Officials refused to comment on the reports that British troops in Greece were going into Yugoslavia because of the lack of authentic information. However, it was denied that the new Yugoslavian government had sent a special envoy to Rome to see Mussolini. In the German point of view, there's no reason why a special Yugoslav representative should be sent to Rome. News from Yugoslavia takes second place in this morning's Berlin Press. The story that the German mayor of a town in Pardani has been killed by Serbs gets a big play, and other tales of anti-German outrages are there. The tone of the press indicates that things are getting hotter for the Germans in Yugoslavia. But most of the top space in the newspapers is given to the announcement that German and Italian troops have retaken the port of Benghazi and that the German report of air activities during the month of March. The German log claims that during 15 night attacks last month, 23 English towns or other important objectives were effectively bombed by strong forces. On each of these nights, it's asserted, hundreds of German machines of all types were over England and Scotland. Several million kilos of high explosives and more than a million incendiary bombs were dropped on what is described important war objectives in all parts of the British Isles. On the other side of the ledger sheet, the Germans claim that the British failed to fly into Germany on 17 nights of the month. Two attacks on Berlin are chalked up to the British. The Germans say they were carried out with only weak formations, while all the other raids were directed against towns in western and northwestern Germany. Today's Supreme Command reports that the total British shipping sunk in March by the Air Force, surface raiders, and U-boats amounts to 718,000 tons. The Air Force gets credit for sinking more than 40 ships, totaling 300,000 tons. The rest goes to U-boats and surface raiders operating on British sea lanes. 18 more ships are said to have been sunk in one convoy yesterday. The High Command says that the British have lost 42 planes since the 1st of April. That's the score for 4 days. 14 planes were shot down in air battles and by anti-aircraft fire, and the other 27 were destroyed on the ground. During the same 4-day period, the Germans admit the loss of 9 planes. According to the High Command, the British in Libya are fleeing toward the north from Benghazi, which German and Italian soldiers took back early yesterday morning. Last night, the harbors of Avonmouth and Great Yarmouth were attacked by what the High Command calls air units of major proportion, but details are lacking. This is Charles Lanius in Berlin. I now return you to NBC in New York.
Now, Earl Godwin reporting from the NBC newsroom in Washington.
Good morning, folks. Regardless of what those Germans told Dick Lanius, or Mr. Charles Lanius, Dick Hartlett, that young UP reporter, according to the view of high officials in this government, is the victim of second-rate Nazi retaliation for this government's action in running down recently a certain Nazi gumshoe agent. And a federal jury in the District of Columbia decided at midnight that the American Medical Association and the District of Columbia Medical Association have violated the Sherman antitrust laws. Actually, that these two professional organizations are trusts in restraint of trade, mind you, trade. They were prosecuted by two vigorous and experienced trust-busting lawyers from the Department of Justice, and the general charge was that the medical associations conspired to restrain and interfere with the work of a cooperative society here known as Group Health, organized among federal employees. Group Health Incorporated is a society of government employees paying $2 a month and get medical service free above that charge. Doctors here and elsewhere, headed by the Chicago headquarters of the American Medical Association, have resented the idea of group health, called it socialized medicine. Many of the doctors were very active. And the profession here at least, here in Washington at least, was deeply shocked and shaken when the government termed them a trust and started after them just as if they were the Standard Oil Company. This trial has lasted 8 weeks. In addition to the associations, there were 18 individual doctors in the same boat. But after a very plain hint from the judge, whose name is Proctor, the jury did not include the individual doctors in their findings. This case, of course, will go to the higher courts. It is interesting in these rapidly changing days to recall that the same section of the Department of Justice that went after the doctors with a red-hot poker went after organized labor in the Carpenters Union for alleged violation of the same trust laws, the same restraint of trade. Now, will the same Supreme Court have the same opinion on professional organizations accused of the same restraint of trade because the Supreme Court said that the labor union wasn't a trust in that case? Well, as the Ford plants close down completely and find evidences of expensive and expansive sabotage in one of the airplane plants there, the National Labor Relations Board here will conduct a hearing on the CIO petition for an election in the Ford River Rouge plant and the Lincoln plant in Detroit. That hearing is scheduled to start today. CIO wants to organize. Ford doesn't want the CIO or any other labor union. Ford's attorney is here or due here. He will charge communism is at work, and the CIO leader, Mr. Frankenstein, says the communism charge is baseless. Yesterday at his morning press conference, the president, for the first time, said he had reports of communistic activities in the labor field. In the coal mines, the management seems to be the side which stops progress today. Lee Steelman says so. The unions have accepted a temporary arrangement by which they go back to work and settle their disputes. The wage raises, if any, to be retroactive. The management says nothing doing, according to the report we have. And John Steelman, the government conciliator, makes a sharp retort which might indicate that the government is going to crack down in coal as well as the Alice Chalmers plant in Milwaukee unless that strike ends soon. And by soon, I would say that the president means about next week. Earl Godwin says goodbye. That's all the news from Washington at this time.
And that's the news at home and abroad up to this moment. For the past quarter hour, we have brought you late news reports from London, Berlin, and Washington. This is the National Broadcasting Company. Good morning, everyone. Today, Friday, April 18th, is the 593rd day of war. This morning, you're to hear from our reporters in Germany and England, and then Earl Godwin, our Washington observer. First, go ahead, Berlin.
Hello, NBC. This is Charles Lanius in Berlin. At noon today, that is about 3 hours ago German time, Yugoslavia ceased to exist as a European nation. Noon was the hour agreed on for the capitulation of the Yugoslavian army to go into effect. Actually, what was left of the Yugoslav army after the 12-day German blitzkrieg surrendered unconditionally at 9 o'clock last night. But the capitulation wasn't to be effective until today at 12 o'clock. The remaining part of the Yugoslav territory has been occupied by the Germans, according to the High Command. The Italians have come down the Dalmatian coast and have occupied Dubrovnik. So today, what looked 2 weeks ago looked like a fairly strong country with a strong army for its size, at least strong enough to challenge the German war machine, is just a war-torn piece of territory in southeastern Europe. Part of young Peter's country is already under a new government, and it's a practical certainty that the rest will be carved up to fit into the Axis New Order plan. Negotiations for the surrender, I understand, were carried on with the commanders of the various remaining Yugoslav armies, and not with the central government. On the Wilhelmstrasse this morning, it was declared that this procedure was followed for the simple reason that the German government had no idea where the Yugoslavian government was. General Simovich is said to be in Athens, but there are other rumors that he has gone to Moscow. The whereabouts of young King Peter is also a mystery here at present. An official stated that the new order in the Balkans would begin to take shape very soon, but refused to comment further. Previously, it was declared officially that the Serbs would have nothing to say about the new ordering in the southeast. At the same time, it was announced that Germany is preparing to open their legation in Zagreb, the capital of New Croatia, which Germany and Italy both formally recognized last Tuesday. Incidentally, this town from now on will be called Agram again instead of Zagreb, which is the Yugoslavian name. It was also learned that the German ambassador to Turkey in Moscow had been called to Berlin. The veteran diplomat von Papen is on his way here from Ankara to discuss the Turkey situation. Ambassador von der Schulenburg, Germany's envoy to Moscow, is already here to report. Here in Berlin, we had visitors again early this morning. A brief German bulletin today says that a number of Royal Air Force planes approached Berlin, but that only a few of them succeeded in penetrating the air barrage around the capital. It adds that some fires were caused in residential quarters and that, again, cultural centers were damaged. The Germans claim that 6 British planes were shot down, 2 of them near Berlin. I think I saw both of the planes that were shot down. One of them I watched while it circled the city, caught in the giant searchlights with anti-aircraft fire bursting all around it. As it made the circle, it lost height and was obviously in difficulties. It got lower and lower, and when it was almost on the horizon on the other side of the city, from where I was, it suddenly seemed to disappear altogether, and the searchlights went out. After what seemed to me to be about only 30 seconds, the whole sky where the plane had disappeared was lighted up with a huge flash, the kind of crashing plane which had burst into flames would make. The second plane hove into sight with smoke pouring from its tail. Still, it was able to navigate. It began to wobble. Then, also in the searchlight beams, it began to dive and twist with the tail of smoke still trailing behind. As it got lower, the pilot apparently tried to right the machine, but it went into another dive. The last I saw of the plane, it wasn't a dive. Then some buildings obscured my view. The attacks weren't just confined to Berlin. The British bombed several other points in northern Germany during the night, but the Germans say the damage was slight. On their side, the German Air Force is said to have sent strong formations over England again. An important harbor town on the English south coast was bombed by waves of bombers, according to the Germans. The pilots say they dropped bombs of all calibers and caused much destruction in the shipyards and harbor installations. The bomb city isn't named in the special German bulletin. Down in Greece, the Germans are attacking the British and the Greeks, but there's very little information on how the fighting is going. It's said here, but unofficially, that the Greeks are weakening with the pressure from both the Germans and Italians. Now, with Yugoslavia cleared out of the way, the entire German forces in the southeast may be turned against the Greeks. Ask any German, and he'll tell you that the German armies will clean up in Greece in just as short order as they did in Yugoslavia. A little sidelight on French affairs was given out in the Wilhelmstrasse today. According to this story, the French have released a number of political prisoners on Madagascar and other French islands. One of the released men is said to be Abdul Krim, the famous Rif leader who has been in Reunion Island for years. This is Charles Lanius in Berlin. I now return you to NBC in New York.
Though our office in London was demolished in Wednesday night's raid, there hasn't been any interruption in our schedule of reports from that devastated city. And so our staff reporter is ready with his regular morning newscast. Go ahead, London.
This is London, Ed Doyle speaking. This is the day of the great inquest, a double inquest, one on the reverses in the Near East and one on the devastating air raid. The popular clamor for reprisals against the civilian population of Germany is drowned by the clamor for an inquest on the government. Tempers, not nerves, are undoubtedly frayed. Nobody is angry because he is afraid. A great many people are angry, however, because they feel the government isn't moving fast enough in all sorts of directions to get into a winning stride. The Reserve Manchester Guardian suggests that in moments like these, a national government makes for the stifling of criticism. The members of the small all-party ginger group in the House of Commons have met to consider the formation of a national opposition. Members of the group include Lord Winterton, Emmanuel Shinwell, Honorine Bevan, Clement Davies, and Kenneth Lindsay. They want a bolder policy all along the line. In finance, manpower mobilization, shipping, agriculture, airplane production, and the construction of shelters. The Daily Herald also urges that Parliament ought to overhaul the whole situation. We hear the familiar cry from the armchairs of the Complacency Club, "Let us have no inquest," the paper states. It adds, quote, "We don't want to hunt for scapegoats, but we cannot win this war unless we are prepared to learn from our mistakes," unquote. Some of the questions it asks are, how did the enemy contrive to land such a powerful force in Tripoli? How did they manage to land fuel supplies and men by air when the British controlled the important aerodrome at Benghazi? It admits that the task of holding the Germans in Greece and Yugoslavia was difficult from the very beginning. But behind all these isolated and perfectly obvious clues to a major default, there lurks in the minds of many people a more fundamental flaw. These people believe that the major weakness of the Allies lies in the political diplomatic side of the war picture. There is a tendency to sit and wait for the enemy to make an attack and then pick out a suitable general to make a defensive stand. What is needed, therefore, is an offensive, aggressive policy. And this, in nearly all cases, has a political diplomatic basis. It includes the government's policy towards Vichy France and Spain. These people still want to know what is being done to hold French Morocco and Spanish Morocco, meaning Gibraltar. Iraq is looked upon as a major political, not military, blunder. The anger in more moderate form is shared also by the conservative Daily Telegraph. Whether or not our answer to the devastation of Wednesday night must be bombing reprisals on Germany, the paper insists that the only immediate answer is the production of more planes and yet more planes. We must make the air force so powerful, the Telegraph urges, that the German industrial machine and German nerve power will be broken. The call is not only to workers at the bench and foundry. Everyone can contribute by reducing personal demands on supplies of labor, which factories need. The Daily Mail warns that all the people's efforts will be needed in the coming months. The RAF bombed Berlin last night. It was the heaviest attack yet made on the city. The Air Ministry stated that a number of very powerful bombs were dropped on targets in the center of the town. Fires were started, and it is said that a substantial amount of damage was certainly done. Mr. Herbert Morrison, Minister of Home Security, told the civil defense men and women that Berlin was bombed according to plan. Mr. Morrison also revealed that the new Stirling bomber was used on the raid in Berlin. The RAF yesterday in daylight attacked Cherbourg and also merchant shipping. Bombs were dropped on targets in Holland, including Cologne and Rotterdam, and places in northwest Germany as well as Berlin. 8 British planes are missing from these operations. Raids on this country last night were directed mainly against Portsmouth. The attack was fairly heavy and lasted for most of the night. Casualties were light, says the communique, and damage not severe. There were activities in other districts, principally in the south, east, northeast, and in all these districts, casualties were few and no substantial damage was done. 2 German bombers were shot down. I return you now to the National Broadcasting Company in New York.
That's the news abroad. And now Earl Godwin reports from our newsroom in Washington.
Good morning, folks. Three United States senators are in the draft news today. You remember Senator Ellison Smith of South Carolina, who did not like it at all because the local draft board selected his son, who happens to be secretary of the Senate Committee on Agriculture. But the local board says a secretary to a Senate committee is not essential to our defense. Then come the two Delaware senators who have obtained deferment for relatives on the ground that they are essential to defense. Randolph Hughes, a 33-year-old nephew and secretary for Senator Hughes of Delaware, signed the certificate, and the Delaware local draft board placed Randolph Hughes in a deferred class. Senator James Tunnell said he helped his son, Robert, 26, to a Class 2 deferment. In Delaware, a draft board there in Sussex County, on the ground that he operates a string of chicken farms, has 49,000 chickens, made him an essential to national defense. And the reason I relate those to you is because, in contrast, here is a letter I received from a mother in Massachusetts who listens daily to this program. Senator Smith, said this mother, should not worry about his son, as we all face the same thing in regard to our boys. My son has been a farmer for 2 years, and 3 years ago he was very ill. Being brought up on a farm, he got interested to go farming, so we let him have 10 acres. So he started. He was doing well, selling vegetables to wholesale market. Started a small fruit business, saved his money, and had 1,800 chickens. Also, later, about 800 more. But that didn't make any difference to the draft board or to Uncle Sam. So the boy sold what he could at a loss and lost the rest, which were too small to sell. The grain man trusted him. We felt he had left a grain bill behind. So does the grain man. But he's lost all that he worked so hard for. He was wholly responsible for everything. We were sorry. We could not help him. But there is a family to take care of, and his father is getting on in years and old and isn't able to help. See what he faces when he comes out of the army. We thought the farmer was a very good soldier to help feed the people. Senator Smith mustn't feel badly about his son going, because mine has gone, and all his plans are gone, too. I will watch with great interest Senator Smith's progress. You know, I think there's more that gets into the consciousness of that letter than in all the news from all the rest of the world together today. But however, to get back to formal news, the government is worried by the continued soft coal strike, which cuts down industrial production. They can't run some of the plants without coal, you know. John Lewis, coal mine union chief, has that situation by the short hair, and the president may be asked to intervene. The House has before it the Vinson Bill, which prohibits strikes in defense industries until after a 25-day cooling-off period, in which time every sort of persuasion will be used to settle problems without lockouts or strikes. The administration does not want such legislation yet, at least. The Vinson Bill may pass the House, but it's quite likely to be smothered in the Senate, unless something entirely unforeseen occurs. Well, we may have a hot debate in the Senate today over that controversial convoy question. Senator Toby, that New Hampshire Republican who's up in arms about the convoy matter, indicates he's going to discuss all phases of the matter on the floor of the upper house. And if he does, you may see or hear of fireworks. Toby believes we are practically convoying now and predicts shooting. Earl Godwin says goodbye. That's all from Washington at this time.
In Europe, it is already Friday afternoon. Reports of events that have taken place during the night and early morning are still coming into our newsroom. And for this reason, we suggest that you remain tuned to this station. In addition to our regular news periods, we will broadcast important bulletins as soon as they are received. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
Let us start with first things first. The principle which guides us about news is to tell the truth and nothing but the truth. The Germans have no such principle, as I shall show you. We should like to tell you not only the truth, but the whole truth as soon as we can get it. We know that you can take it, and take it much more easily than silence. In the ministry, we've never had any doubt about that. We should like you to regard the giving and receiving of news as a kind of partnership in which there is mutual confidence and cooperation. If we try to get you the news as fully and quickly as we can, we want you, on your part, not to lose confidence if you have to wait for it, and not to make up for lack of news by a crop of rumors. But if you are to do this for us, we must help you to understand the difficulties we have in doing our part of the work. Of course, it must often happen that we haven't got the news. But when we have, the only reason why we ever withhold anything from you is because if we tell you, we cannot help telling the enemy at the same time. And there are some things it's better he should not know, or should have to find out for himself. There is a great difference in this respect between the present war and the war of 1914-18. This time, we have got broadcasting, so that the whole world can listen in. This time, this island, our cities and our countryside are in the front line, so that information about what is going on here is much more valuable to the enemy than it was last time. And what's more, the enemy is always trying to coax information out of us by what I can only describe as kite flying. For instance, at the beginning of this year, he wanted to know whether the Illustrious, one of our aircraft carriers, had been sunk in the Mediterranean action. So on the 20th of January 1941, he flew his kite, and it was done this way. The German wireless on that day said, "It will scarcely be disputed that the most serious loss the Navy suffered was that of the Illustrious. Whether she lingers on the surface or has gone to the bottom, it is quite certain that she cannot be used any more during the course of the war." Well, it was tempting to say she had not gone to the bottom, and that she would be a lot more use to us before the war was over. But that was just what the enemy wanted to know. And if he was told, it might risk the lives of our men. So he wasn't told, and everyone had to endure the silence till she was repaired and safely away. And then, 20 days later, on the 9th of February, the Prime Minister told you the true story in these words. All the necessary repairs were made to the Illustrious in Malta Harbour, and she steamed safely off to Alexandria under her own power at 23 knots. You will understand now what I mean when I say that in giving you the news, we try to tell you the truth and nothing but the truth, but we cannot always tell you the whole truth as quickly as we wish. But the Germans, as I said, work on a quite different principle. They tell the truth when it suits them and a lie when it doesn't. They always said they'd do this. It's in Hitler's Bible, Mein Kampf. Propaganda, he wrote, must present only that aspect of the truth which is favorable to its own side. And he expressed a preference for the big lie, on the ground that the broad masses of the nation more readily fall victims to the big lie than to the small lie. Now, the enemy gets certain advantages from not worrying whether he tells the truth or not. His method is quicker than ours. If we want to tell the truth, we have got to find it out first. When the fighting is a long way off and confused, the truth takes time to discover. We may, for instance, have to wait for news of a naval engagement until His Majesty's ships have got back to harbour. And it's a long way from Matapan back to harbour. But to use wireless before getting back to port might betray the positions of our ships. Or again, if we want to tell the truth about the results of an air raid on Germany, we must wait till the pilots have got back and they and their reports have been carefully examined. But the Germans can and do tell you what they want you to hear, true or false, or more often half true and half false, as soon as they wish. Finding out the truth is a slow business. If you're prepared to fill in gaps by invention, you can save a lot of time. But you save it at some cost. I'm quite sure of one thing. We must stick to our rule of trying to find out and tell the truth and nothing but the truth. It is because we try to do this that people listen to our news and rely on it, not only in British and Allied countries, but in neutral countries, in enemy-occupied territories, and even in Germany and in Italy themselves. If it be said that we are not always first with the news, I say that depends on what you mean by the news. We are first with what can be relied upon as the truth.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's time again for you to hear from our reporters in England, Germany, and Washington. This morning, John McVane reports from London, Theodore Knaut from Berlin, and Earl Godwin gives you his observations and findings in Washington from our newsroom in that city. First, let's hear from our reporter in England. Go ahead, London.
This is London. German raids on Britain last night were on a small scale. Bombs fell in southeast and northeast England, but casualties and damage are said to be small. Thousands of firebombs fell on a district in southern England, but only one big fire was started, and that was soon put out. London had its second successive night without a raid alarm. The Royal Air Force last night attacked Kiel and Wilhelmshaven. Kiel was the main objective, and fires were raised in the shipyards and industrial areas. Other attacks were made during the night on docks and other objectives on the coasts of Norway, Holland, Belgium, and France. Two British planes didn't return to their base. In daylight yesterday, a tanker was set on fire off the coast of Norway by the Bomber Command, and fighters carried out offensive patrols over aerodromes in occupied France. Dispatches reaching London from Vichy say that the French Pacific island of Tahiti has declared itself for General de Gaulle. A ship's company is said to have mutinied and seized the governor's palace and the arsenal. Most of the Frenchmen on the island rallied to the Free French General, and there was little fighting. The British government announced today that new minefields have been laid along the coasts of Libya and Egypt, and along the Turkish, Greek, Albanian, Yugoslavian, and Italian coasts. The British announcement noted that the German and Italian governments have recently announced that the Eastern Mediterranean, the Aegean Sea, and the greater part of the Adriatic are dangerous to shipping. Today's London press features without comment the statements made yesterday by Mr. Hull and Colonel Knox. Accounts of the speech, cabled from New York, indicate to British readers that America is about ready to convoy war supplies and food to Britain. Typical front-page headlines on the story in British papers are "Convoys, decision is imminent," and "Atlantic convoys soon" is U.S. hint. The Balkan campaign and the German thrust to Egypt have brought home to the average Britisher the realization that the British Navy, in trying to guard the Atlantic lifelines and at the same time keep control of the Mediterranean, has more work than it can handle. At the present rate, British merchant shipping losses in the Atlantic are extremely serious. We have no figures on the percentage of American war materials that are being sunk, but Lord Beaverbrook's reference to a steady drain on such materials from German attacks confirmed what most Britishers have long suspected. The Manchester Guardian today lends point to the argument that full American support is necessary for an Allied victory by an editorial entitled "Still Half-Armed." The Guardian emphasizes that in current output of arms, Germany is still well ahead of Britain alone, and that although figures are difficult to get, Germany may be spending at least a third more for armaments than Britain. The Guardian says Germany is spending 60% to 70% of its gross national income for arms, while Britain is still spending about half. The paper points out that by 1942, the combined war effort of Britain and the United States will outstrip Germany. Most informed Britishers are worried about the war materials that are being sunk at a time when Britain needs every gun and every plane she can get. The problem of the British Navy is now, and has been for several months, how to spare the naval vessels necessary to give a convoy proper protection. convoys have been brought through safely with far fewer escort vessels than the minimum thought necessary. But many sinkings have been due to the fact that two or three destroyers were trying to do the work of 10. Aircraft carriers and more long-range fighters could probably nullify the threat of the long-distance German bombers. But here again, the British have their hands full in the Mediterranean and can't spare the aircraft for the Atlantic. You may remember how the German penetration of Bulgaria and Romania started, with Germans in civilian clothes quietly taking over key points. Today, dispatches reaching London from Lisbon seem to indicate that the same method is being followed in Spain. One report published in the London Times says that at least 2,500 Germans are now in Madrid in various guises. Aerodromes up and down Spain, the Times correspondent says, have their full complement of German ground staffs and supplies. And in the starving country, there are big German dumps of food and gasoline at strategic points. The Daily Telegraph says that these food stores may be stocked partly with American and British supplies recently shipped to Spain. Careful check is kept on the food assignments, and it was found recently that a considerable quantity of wheat had mysteriously disappeared, although it was known that none had left the country. The amount is said to be too large to be accounted for by petty theft or private hoarding, and it is believed the Germans, acting through agents, bought the food supplies and stored them for an emergency. This is John McVane in London, returning you to the National Broadcasting Company in New York.
In just 10 hours from now, 600 days under the darkness of war will have become history to most of the peoples of England and Germany. Let's hear now from another of our staff of American radio reporters keeping you abreast of developments abroad. All right, Berlin.
NBC, this is Theodore Knaut speaking from Berlin. The German command announces that Captain Otto Kretschmar, one of Germany's most successful submarine commanders and decorated with the oak leaves of the Iron Cross, is a prisoner in the hands of the British. German troops have taken the pass of Thermopylae after a stubborn defense by Australian troops, who in their retreat were forced to leave behind them much war material and prisoners as well. Panic is said to prevail in Athens, but the news that the city has been taken by the Germans is not confirmed here. It will be announced when the time comes, but the Germans are risking no unnecessary losses in the last stages either of their advance into Greece. In Greek and Cretan waters, further numerous transport ships were hit by German bombs yesterday. 37 planes were destroyed in a flying field at Argos, and 6 more at Madeira, as well as 26 motor cars. Yesterday's bombing of England took place at an unnamed town on the southern coast, and in southeastern England, and the British too raided German coastal towns, with damage, it is announced here, only to residential districts. Yesterday, Adolf Hitler received the Regent of Hungary, Admiral Horthy, in his headquarters in the field, the location of which is a matter of mystery. This is the third of such meetings to be held this past week, following that of King Boris of Bulgaria on Sunday, and of Count Ciano of Italy at about the same time. And it is a safe guess that all three of them are connected with the rearrangement that is due to take place in the Balkan Peninsula at the expense of Yugoslavia. Hungary, Bulgaria, and Italy, too, may be expected to benefit by the German victory in the way of enlarged territory for themselves. The address of Colonel Lindbergh in New York, urging America to keep out of the war and interpreted here as giving up England's cause as lost, is given wide attention and is fairly extensively quoted. The return of Matsuoka to Japan and the ratification of the pact he made with Russia, which now goes into effect, gives the Furkischer Beobachter an opportunity to review his trip to Europe and the results that it achieved. The value of direct contact with the heads of the Axis powers, Japan's allies in the three-power pact, is stressed. The pact with Russia has freed Japan from the danger of having to fight a war on two fronts. In the end, strengthens the three-power pact position and puts a stop to Anglo-American intrigues, the paper believes, and from American and British press comments, the Japanese people can take a certain grim satisfaction as it realizes the grief that is hidden behind the somewhat cool way in which the pact has been received. America will have to be more careful in its Far Eastern policy. The Chinese must be disillusioned, but there are still great obstacles in the way of Japan's mission in the Far East. Matsuoka's task is not yet ended, but he can start from a much better position in carrying on his policy further. So thinks the Turkish Oberbeamter. The problem of providing Germany with light beer, reminiscent of the near beer of American Prohibition days, was taken up seriously by the assembled German brewers in their convention in Munich, says the Deutsche Allgemeine Zeitung. Light beer must be tasty, refreshing, nutritious, cheap, and it must not have more than 0.5% of alcohol, which is the point on which Dr. Conti, the head of the health department, insists the most. So far, the new beverage does not seem to have got beyond the experimental stage, and while the brewers say that they are quite prepared to go ahead, their enthusiasm does not seem to be very great. In any event, the efforts of Dr. Conti in his fight against alcohol and tobacco will be followed with sympathetic interest in America when it thinks back on the Prohibition era. And speaking of tobacco, I may say that the German housewives take a smiling pleasure at the sight of their menfolk standing in line in front of the tobacco shops to get their daily cigar or package of cigarettes. Cigar stores take a longer noon closing period than ever now, and the sign that indicates no goods on hand are on display more often than not. And when even a small crowd is seen outside a store, it is an indication that something is to be had there, and at once a line forms, while the housewives on their way back from market chuckle to themselves. Spain and Portugal are coming back into the news now, but it is insisted here that German threats to both those countries are a device of British propaganda, anxious to distract attention from the Balkan and North African defeats, and anxious to stir up trouble elsewhere. This is Theodore Knaut speaking from Berlin and returning you to NBC.
You've heard from John McVane in London and Theodore Knaut in Berlin. Now, Earl Godwin reports to you from our newsroom in Washington.
Good morning, folks. And in the midst of all the confusion, it must have been reassuring to Britain, at least, to hear the unperturbed Cordell Hull, our Secretary of State, and many of us think that he's America's deepest thinking and clearest thinking statesman, tell the world that the aid we are endeavoring to manufacture must reach its destination in the shortest time and in maximum quantity, and so ways and means must be found to do this. So also the Secretary of the Navy, Frank Knox, of course, who's been far ahead of the administration on the matter of battling our way across the ocean. Knox has been ready to shoot it out for many months, and so his statement on the subject is nothing new, but there is a world of help to Britain, morally at least, in the firm attitude of the Secretary of State, whose speech last night to the Foreign Policy Association seemed to me to be a masterpiece of disgust and invective against what he calls privately the banditry of the Axis. He envisions the warlords over there as making war without provocation and having ravaged a country trying to kill the souls of the individual people. He sees the greatest thing that people can have is freedom, and Mr. Hull believes it's being slowly poisoned and changed so that life in a ravaged country is no longer happy. And so it is obvious that we are going to get the goods over there, if we're permitted to keep on manufacturing them. And reports are going round that 40% of the goods we have shipped have been sunk. Well, that's not official. It may be true and it may not be true. But one view of the situation was expressed by Representative Patrick of Alabama on the floor of the House, who reminded his colleagues that we are pledged to $7 billion program of aid to our friends in England. Shall we see that go for naught and be scattered all over the bottom of the ocean? Asked Patrick. Davy Jones' locker is no place for the sweat and blood and bone of the American people. It seems to me, and seems to many of us here in Washington who are watching and observing and reporting, that the stage is being set for a stroke, a master stroke of leadership, whether you like it or not. For instance, in addition to the direct action appeals by Secretaries Hull and Knox yesterday, the Secretary of Agriculture, Wickard, who certainly isn't a warlike gentleman, let a neat little hint creep into a speech that he made to farmers. Mr. Wickard declared that the chronicle of the war, from the democracy standpoint, has been a story of, quote, too little and too late, close quote. Did you ever see five words that more aptly expressed the situation? and he asserted that millions of Americans are getting sick of that story. Then also Secretary Morgenthau, who did not have a military theme throughout his tax dissertation yesterday, but in his testimony before the House Ways and Means Committee, Morgenthau asserted that $3.5 billion in new taxes is a small price to pay for liberty. Whatever the price, said Henry Morgenthau Jr., the American people will be willing to pay for it. Now, these speeches may or may not have had combined significance, but we who are watching for you and for your benefit here in Washington believe that they do have a significance that will eventuate in something drastic right soon. And Earl Godwin says goodbye. That's all from Washington at this time.
Tomorrow morning, at the same hour, you'll again hear from our reporters abroad and from Earl Godwin in Washington. Today, we invite you to remain tuned to this station for up-to-the-minute news. Your newspaper lists all of our regularly scheduled news periods. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
I was asked last week whether I was aware of some uneasiness which it was said existed in the country on account of the gravity, as it was described, of the war situation. So I thought it would be a good thing to go and see for myself what this uneasiness amounted to. And I went to some of our great cities and seaports, which have been most heavily bombed, and to some of the places where the poorest people have got it worst. I've come back to the front, by which I mean the streets and wharves of London or Liverpool, Manchester, Cardiff, Swansea, or Bristol. It's like going out of a hothouse onto the bridge of a fighting ship. It is a tonic which I should recommend any who are suffering, and where the ordeal of the men, women, and children has been most severe, that I found their morale most high and splendid. Indeed, I felt encompassed by an exaltation of spirit in the mankind and its troubles above the level of material facts, into that joyous serenity we think belongs to a better world than this. Of their kindness to me, I cannot speak, because I have never thought it or dreamed of it, and can never deserve it. I can only assure you that I and my colleagues, or comrades rather, for that is what they are, will toil with every scrap of life and strength, according to the lights that are granted to us, not to fail these people, or be wholly unworthy of their faithful and generous regard. The British nation is stirred and moved, and it never has been at any time in its long, eventful, famous history. And it is no hackneyed trope of speech to say that they mean to conquer or to die. What a triumph the life of these battered cities is over the worst that fire and bomb can do. What a vindication of the civilized and decent way of living we have been trying to work for and work towards in our island. What a proof of the virtues of free institutions. What a test of the quality of our local authorities and of customs and societies. Centuries had been reserved for the soldiers and sailors are now shared for good or ill by the entire population. All are proud of being under the fire of the enemy. Old men, little children, the crippled, veterans of former wars, aged women, the ordinary hard-pressed citizen or subject of the king, as he likes to call himself, the sturdy workmen who swing the hammers or load the ships, the skillful craftsmen, the members of every kind of ARP service, are proud to feel that they stand in the line together with our fighting men when one of the greatest causes is being fought out, and fought out it will be to the end. This indeed is the grand heroic period of our history, and the light of glory shines on all. You may imagine how deeply I feel my own responsibility to all these people. My response to their sacrifices and exertions in vain. I have thought in this difficult period, when so much fighting and so many critical and complicated maneuvers are going on, that it is above all things important that our policy and conduct should be upon the highest level, and that honor should be our guide. Very few people realize how small were the forces with which General, whom we cheered in good days and will back too bad, how small were the forces which took the bulk of the Italian masses in Libya prisoners. In none of his successive victories could General Wavell maintain in the desert or bring into action at one time more than two divisions, or about 30. A call was made upon us which we could not resist. Let me tell you about that call. You will remember how in November the Italian dictator fell upon the unoffending Greeks, hurled his armies back at the double quick. Meanwhile, Hitler, who had been creeping and worming his way steadily forward, doping and poisoning and pinioning one after the other, Hungary, Romania, and Bulgaria, suddenly made it clear that he would come to the rescue of his fellow criminals. While nearly all the Greek troops were busy beating the Italians, the tremendous German military machine suddenly powered up on their other frontier. In their mortal peril, the Greeks turned to us for succor. Strained as were our resources, we could not say them nay. By solemn guarantee, given before the war, Great Britain had promised them her help. They declared they would fight for their native soil, even if neither of their neighbors made common cause with them, and even if we left them to their fate. But we could not do that. There are rules against that kind of thing, and to break those rules would be fatal to the honor of the British Empire, without which we could neither hope nor deserve to win this hard war. Military defeat or miscalculation can be redeemed. The fortunes of war are fickle and changing, but an act of shame would deprive us of the respect which we now enjoy throughout the world, and thus would sap a potent hold upon the sentiments of the people of the United States. Never, never in our long history have we been held in such admiration and regard across the Atlantic Ocean. In that great republic, now in much travail and stress of soul, it is which depend upon the destruction of Hitler and his foul gang, and even fouler doctrines. But in the long run, believe me, for I know, the action of the United States will be dictated not by methodical calculations of profit and loss, but by moral sentiment and by that gleaming flash of resolve which lifts the hearts of men and nations and springs from the spiritual foundation of human life itself. We, for our part, were, of course, bound to hearken to the Greek appeal to the utmost limit of our strength. We put the case, we did. So an important part of the mobile portion of the Army of the Nile was sent to Greece in fulfillment of our pledge. It happened that the divisions available and best suited to this task were the mother country. I see the German propaganda is trying to make bad blood between us and Australia by making out that we have used them to do what we would not have asked of the British Army. I shall leave it to Australia to deal with that taunt. Let us see what has happened. We knew, of course, that the forces we could send to Greece would not by themselves of Greece would by our intervention be drawn to stand in the line together with her while time remains. How nearly that came off will be known someday. The tragedy of Yugoslavia has been that the immunity by submission to the Nazi will. Thus, when at last the people of Yugoslavia found out where they were being taken and rose in one spontaneous surge of revolt, they saved the soul and future of their country, but it went already to save its territory. They had no time to mobilize this and highly mechanized Hun before they could even bring their armies into the field. Great disasters have occurred in the Balkans. Yugoslavia has been beaten down. Only in the mountains can she continue her resistance. The Greeks have been overwhelmed. Their victorious Albanian army has been cut off and forced to surrender. And it has been left to the Anzacs and their British comrades to fight their way back to the sea, leaving their mark on all who hindered them. To indulge a moment of lighter relief, I dare say you have read in the newspaper that by a special proclamation, the Italian dictator has congratulated the Italian army over the Greeks. Here, surely, is the world's record in the domain of the ridiculous and the contemptible. This ripped-jostle state of Hitler's empire comes frisking up at the side of the German tiger with yelpings not only of appetite, that could be understood, but even of triumph. In different ways, but I am sure there are a great many millions in the British Empire and in the United States who will find a new object in life in making sure that when we come to the final reckoning, this absurd imposter shall be abandoned to public justice and universal scorn. While these grievous events were taking place in the Balkan Peninsula and in Greece, our forces in Libya have sustained a vexatious and damaging defeat. The Germans advanced sooner and in greater strength than we or our generals expected. The bulk of our armored troops, which had played such a decisive part in beating the Italians, had to be refitted, and the single armored brigade, which had been judged sufficient to hold the frontier till about the middle of May, was worsted and its vehicles largely destroyed by a somewhat stronger German armored force. Our infantry, which did not exceed one division, we had to fall back upon the very large imperial armies that have been assembled and can be nourished and maintained in the fertile delta of the Nile. Tobruk, the fortress of Tobruk, which flanks any German advance on Egypt, we hold strongly. There we have repulsed many attacks, causing the enemy heavy losses and taking many prisoners. That is how the matter stands in Libya and on the Egyptian front. We must now expect the war in the Mediterranean, on the sea, in the desert, and above all in the air, to become very fierce, varied, and widespread. We have cleaned the Italians out of Cyrenaica, and it now lies with us to purge that province of the Germans. That will be a harder task, and we cannot expect to do it at once. You know, I never try to make out that defeats are victories. I have never underrated the German as a warrior. Indeed, I told you a month ago that the swift, unbroken course of victories which we had gained over the Italians could not possibly continue, and that misfortunes must be expected. There is only one thing certain about war, that it is full of disappointments and also full of mistakes. It remains to be seen, however, whether it is the Germans who have made the mistake in trampling down the Balkan states and in making a river of blood and hate between themselves and the Greek and Yugoslav people. It remains also to be seen whether they have made a mistake in their attempt to invade Egypt with the force of by experience. I make it a rule not to prophesy about battles which have yet to be fought out. This, however, I will venture to say, that I should be very sorry to see the tasks of the combat of personal opinion. I can well understand there may be different views. It is certain that fresh dangers may spread eastward to Turkey and Russia. The Germans may lay their hands for a time upon the granaries of the Ukraine and the oil wells of the Caucasus. They may dominate the Black Sea. They may dominate the Caspian. Who can tell? We shall do our best to meet them and fight them wherever they go. But there is one thing which is certain. There is one thing which rises out of the vast welter, which is sure and solid, and which no one in his senses can mistake. Hitler cannot find safety from avenging justice in the East, in the Middle East, or in the Far East. In order to win this war, he must either conquer this island by invasion, or he must cut the ocean lifeline which joins us to the United States. Let us look into these alternatives. If you will, many people believed the Nazi boastings that the invasion of Britain was about to begin. Now, it has not begun yet, and we must now guard our island. When I compare the position at home as it is today with what it was in the summer of last year, even after making allowance for a much more elaborate mechanical preparation on the part of the enemy, I feel that we have very much to be thankful for. And I believe that provided our exertions and our vigilance are not relaxed, even for a moment, we may be confident that we shall give a very good account of ourselves. More than that, it would be boastful to say, if so many of our merchant ships are sunk that we cannot bring in the food we need to nourish our brave people, what is the supplies of war materials and war weapons which the United States are seeking to send us in such enormous quantities should in large part be sunk on the way? In one of his raving outbursts, threatened us with a terrifying increase on our island, but thanks to his use of French and Norwegian harbors, and thanks to the denial to us of the Irish bases, fall upon our shipping far out into the Atlantic. We have taken and are taking all possible measures to meet this deadly Navy and Air Force. By the hundreds of mine-sweeping vessels, which with their marvelous appliances keep our ports clear in spite of all the enemy can do. By the men who build and repair our immense fleets of merchant ships, by the men who load and unload them, and need I say, by the officers and men of the merchant navy, who go out in all weathers and in the teeth of all dangers to fight for the life of their native land and for a cause they comprehend and serve. Still, when you think how easy it is to sink ships at sea, and how hard it is to build them and protect them. And when you remember that we have never less than 2,000 ships afloat, and 300 or 400 in the danger zone, when you think of the great armies we are maintaining and reinforcing in the East, and of the worldwide traffic we have to carry on, when you remember all this, Can you wonder that it is the Battle of the Atlantic which holds the first place in the thoughts of those upon whom rests the responsibility for procuring the victory? It was, therefore, with indescribable relief that I learned of the tremendous decisions lately taken by the President and people of the United States. The American fleet and flying boats have been ordered to patrol the wide waters of the Western Hemisphere and to warn the peaceful shipping of all nations outside the combat zone of the presence of lurking U-boats or raiding cruisers belonging to the two aggressor nations. We, British, will therefore be able to concentrate our protecting forces far more upon the routes nearer home and to take a far heavier toll of the U-boats there. I felt for some time that something like this was bound to happen. The President and Congress of the United States, having newly fortified themselves by contact with their electors, have solemnly pledged their aid to Britain in this war because they deem our cause just and because they know their own interests and safety would be endangered if we were destroyed. They are taxing themselves heavily. They have passed great legislation. They have turned a large part of their gigantic industry to making the munitions which we need. They've even given us or lent us valuable weapons of their own. I could not believe that they would allow the high purposes to which they have set themselves to be frustrated and the products of their skill and labor sunk to the bottom of the sea. U-boat warfare, as conducted by Germany, is entirely contrary to international agreements freely subscribed to by Germany only a few years ago. There is no effective blockade, but only a merciless murder and marauding over wide indiscriminate areas utterly beyond the control of the German sea power. When I said 10 weeks ago, give us the tools and we will finish the job, I meant give them to us. Put them within our reach. It now seems the Americans are going to do. And that is why I feel a very strong conviction that though the Battle of the Atlantic will be long and hard, and its issue is by no means yet determined, it has entered upon a more grim, but at the same time a far more favorable phase. When you come to think of it, the United States are very closely bound up with us now and have engaged themselves deeply in giving us moral, material, and within the limits I have mentioned, naval support. It is just worthwhile, therefore, taking a look on both sides of the ocean at the forces which are facing each other in this awful struggle from which there can be no drawing back. No prudent and far-seeing man can doubt that the eventual and total defeat of Hitler and Mussolini is certain in view of the respective declared resolves of the British and American democracy. There are less than 70 million malignant Huns, some of whom are curable and others killable, most of whom are already engaged in holding down Austrians, Czechs, Poles, and the many other ancient races they now bully and pillage. The peoples of the British Empire and of the United States number nearly 200 million in their homeland and in the British dominions alone. They possess the unchallengeable command of the oceans, and will soon obtain decisive superiority in the air. They have more wealth, more technical resources, and they make more steel than the whole of the rest of the world put together. They are determined that the cause of freedom shall not be trampled down, nor the tide of world progress turned backwards by the criminal dictators. While, therefore, we naturally view with sorrow and anxiety much that is happening in Europe and in Africa and may happen in Asia, we must not lose our sense of proportion and thus become discouraged or alarmed. When we face with a steady eye the difficulties which lie before us, we may derive new confidence by remembering those we have already overcome. Nothing that is happening now is comparable in gravity with the dangers through which we passed last year. Nothing that can happen in the East is comparable with what is happening in the West. Last time I spoke to you, I quoted the lines of Longfellow, which President Roosevelt had written out for me in his own hand. I have some other lines, which are well known, but which seem apt and appropriate to our fortunes tonight, and I believe they will be so judged wherever the English language is spoken or the flag of freedom flies. For while the tired waves vainly breaking seem here no painful inch to gain, far back through creeks and inlets making comes silent flooding in the main, and not by eastern windows only, when daylight comes in the light. In front the sun climbs slow, how slowly, but westward, look, the land is bright.